presence into the house of the Lord. This is the day that he has made for us. Let us be glad and worship in it. Thank you all. Have a wonderful day.
Good morning. Our opening hymn is hymn 101. If you would stand with me, hymn 101. Everyone with me. Children of the Heavenly Father, safely in his bosom gather. Nestling bird nor star in heaven, such a refuge here was given. God his own doth tend and nourish, in his holy courts they flourish. From all evil things he spares them, in his mighty arm he bears them. Ladies with me now. Neither life nor death shall ever from the Lord his children sever. Unto them his grace he showeth, and their sorrows as he knoweth. Men with me. Praise the Lord in joyful numbers. Your protector never slumbers. At the will of your defender, every foe man must surrender. Everyone now. Though he giveth or he taketh, God his children ne'er forsaketh. He's the loving purpose holy to preserve them pure and holy. Remain standing for prayer.
Let us bow. Dear Heavenly Father, we are grateful for the opportunity to come into your holy space and worship you, Lord. We thank you for being able to make it out here. We are praying for those who are on their way that they would get here safe with no worries, no hurt, no harm. Lord, for those who are not able to be here at all with us, we ask that you would bless them and keep them. We thank you for the Sabbath. Again, you made this day for us, so we ask that you would help us to express our love and our joy just for knowing you, just for who you are, Lord. As we go into this worship service today, I ask that you would be with each participant, Lord, that you would let your words flow from the mouths of our speaker, that you would let your thoughts emanate from those who will stand before you. Lord, we ask that you would be the center of this worship service. We ask that you would teach us how to worship you in spirit and in truth, as you have asked that we give ourselves as a living sacrifice to you, Lord. Let us present ourselves fully open and surrender to you. Lord, we again thank you for this day of days, and we ask that you would be with us as we go home and we continue to celebrate the Sabbath. When those hours end, may we never leave your presence throughout this entire week. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Worthington Adventist loves kids. Parents love it when kids go back to school. Amen? Amen. It is almost that time of year. And so we want to take a moment to honor our teachers that are going to be on the receiving end of our children. First, though, I do want to say we are starting a new theme in Children's Church today, in case you haven't guessed. Psalm 23 is going to be our theme, and so we're going to be talking about sheep throughout the next year. It's going to be a great theme, and it's a perfect setup for back to school. right, teachers, would you come join me here at the front? Those of you that teach in early education, elementary, secondary, maybe postgraduate, college age, teachers, come right up here, stand on the stage, let's make a line. We're gonna take a moment to introduce our teachers, and we'll have a special prayer of dedication for them as well. Right. We're going to start over here on my right. If you ladies would introduce yourselves to us, where you work and what you do there.
I'm Gina Schell and I teach in Johnstown, second grade.
I'm Tara Thompson. I teach third grade across the street.
I'm Lydia Levy. I teach fifth and sixth at WAA.
I'm Barbara Maycock. I teach fourth grade at WAA.
My name is Valerie Green, and I'm the principal at WAA.
I am Linda Davis, and I teach first and second at Worthington.
And I'm Carmi Uzunian, and I teach kindergarten at WA.
Okay, do we have any other teachers that are hiding here? I see the fingers being pointed. Come on, Mr. Maycock, come up here. You know, teachers, they like to give the orders, but when it comes to following them, they are just like, no, no. Okay, any other fingers that we need to be pointing? Okay. All right, there's always one. There's always one black sheep in every crowd, okay? All right, would you introduce yourself to us, please, and tell us where you work, what you do?
My name is Sean Maycock, and I teach at Columbus Adventist Academy.
Okay, and what grades?
I teach 6th through 8th math and social studies, and I'm married to Barbara Maycock.
Also very important. All right, teachers, it's good to have you here, ladies and gentlemen. Pastor Jeremy has a word for us.
All right, I'm going to stand down here, if that's okay, so I can see all of your beautiful and handsome faces. I have a little encouragement to give you this morning, but on behalf of the leadership team here at Worthington, we just want to say thank you for all you do. Being a teacher, working in the school is not easy. It is stressful, and there are pressures on you day in and day out, both from higher places like the state and also from parents as well. And so I know it's not easy to be a teacher. So I just want to start off by saying thank you, and we support and pray for you each and every day. My message this morning, or my short encouragement, comes from the book of Galatians, chapter 6. Verse 9, the Apostle Paul is speaking to the church in Galatia, and he says these encouraging words. He says, "And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart." So my challenge for you this morning, this year, really, is to not grow weary in doing good. Each and every one of you are doing good. Whether you can publicly say the name of Jesus in your classroom or not, you are ministering for Jesus wherever you are. And you are showing these children the love of Jesus, and how you act towards them, what you say in your demeanor, is ministering to these kids on behalf of our Lord and Savior Jesus. So please do not grow weary in doing good, because you will reap the reward. There are going to be days where you don't feel like going on. There's going to be days where you feel frustrated. And I hope that in those times, this verse will come to your mind and challenging you to not grow weary in doing good, because one day you will reap the reward of your effort. And I encourage you each and every day before you walk into that classroom to pray to Jesus, "Lord, I surrender my life. Help me to minister to these children through my words and my actions." May that be your prayer each and every day as you darken the doors of the school that you're ministering at. And at this time, our chaplain will have a prayer of dedication.
Heavenly Father, thank you so much For being the master teacher, you have given us the highest example. For each one who is on this stage, for each student going back to school, each parent supporting them, grandparents, support staff, Lord, we ask for a special measure of your blessing. We know that you love kids. Teach us to love kids. Show us how. Show us better methods and better mannerisms and better ways to interact with our students and to let them know how much we love them and how much you love them as well. For each teacher, Lord, I pray for patience that's greater than the year before, understanding greater than the year before, discernment, wisdom, kindness, compassion, all of those things they need as they're working in their classrooms. We ask these things in Jesus' name, knowing that you are more than excited to grant them. In Jesus' name, we all said together, amen. Thank you, teachers. Blessings on the new school year. And at this time, we will call forward the cherubs. So children, would you come down to the front, please? We've got to kick off a story for Children's Church. Good morning, boys and girls. I'm going to tell you something I don't know if you know. Do you know what my favorite animal of all time is? You're right. It's sheep. For 11 summers, I had the opportunity to be a shepherd. I would raise my lambs for 4-H, and I love, love, love sheep. That is so excellent. Also your favorite animal. It should be everyone's favorite animal because they are just so awesome. And like I said, I love sheep, but sheep have not always loved me because I wasn't always a good shepherd. I didn't always know what sheep needed. And I'm gonna give you an example. For example, the first time that we picked out my sheep, we went to someone's house and we got some sheep. And looking back now, they were not really quality sheep, but I didn't know the difference. And we had prepared a pen for them at home, but we'd never had sheep before. We just had horses and we had a few cows. So we made a fence like you would make for horses and cows for sheep. But the thing about sheep is that they really rise to the occasion and they really seek to impress. And I remember my dad, Cowboy Doug, got those sheep out of the trailer and he took them into the pen and I was waiting there. I was so excited. I thought they would love their new home. We had built them a shed. We put special stuff down on the floor. We even installed a fan so they had their own air conditioning system. It was going to be excellent. I just knew they were going to love it. My dad walked them into the pen, the first one, all alone, all by himself. And you know, the thing about that lamb is that he had never been all alone. He had never been by himself. And guess what sheep hate? To be all alone and to be by themselves. So when my dad set him down on the ground, he looked around, he looked one way, he looked at the shed that had air conditioning, he looked at the very meager fence we had provided, And do you know what he said? You're not my shepherd! And he ran through the fence. But you know what he didn't know, boys and girls? Somebody else lived on the other side of that fence. Three very curious horses. And when they saw that they were getting a new neighbor, they came thundering up to check him out and to see who it was. Three great big horses, one tiny 50-pound lamb. Do you know what he said then? You're not my shepherd either! And he started to run as fast as he could. Again, we didn't have very much experience with sheep, so you know what my dad did? He tried to chase after him. Boys and girls, little sheep are slippery little fellows, and he slipped right away. I'm going to tell you the rest of the story when we get to children's church, because we're talking about the lost sheep today. But more importantly, we're talking about a good shepherd, not a shepherd like I was back at the beginning. I had to learn my skills the hard way, but today we're going to talk about the good shepherd. On our way to Children's Church, boys and girls, we're going to pick up the children's offering. I see that many of us are missing name tags. We got to have mom and dad sign us in for Children's Church, and I'll meet you in the fellowship hall. I just want to be
song for Education Day, so we thought about the expense of going to for Christian education. You know, they say that salvation's free, but it can be pretty costly sometimes, right? Because we put two sons through church school, but it was the best thing that we could do. So when you're talking about Christian education, as parents, you got to learn to pray and give it away. Because it's very costly, but it's worthwhile.
If you want more happy than your heart will hold, if you want to stand taller if the truth were told, take whatever you have and give it away. If you want less lonely and a lot more fun and deep satisfaction when the day is done,
design and started breaking off some ears of corn.
Yeah.
Here, boy, today this corn is just right. Boil it up for your supper tonight. I've learned it's true what my pappy used to say. Nothing's quite as good till you give it away. If you want more happy than your heart will hold, if you want to stand taller if the truth were told, take whatever you have and give it away. If you want less ugly and a lot more fun and deep satisfaction when the day is done, throw your heart wide open and give it away.
Oh yeah.
A day in the garden with my Uncle Sam. So I hope you'll hear these words I have to say. There are two kinds of folks, takers and givers. There's gripers and complainers and big-hearted livers. It depends on how we choose to spend our days. We can horn up all we've got.
Church family, it's good to see each and every one of you this morning. Thank you, Bob, Roger, and the kids for blessing us with that song and for ministering to us through music. For those who do not know who I am, my name is Jeremy Wong. I have the privilege of serving as one of the pastors here. I'm not the speaker this morning, but I have the privilege of introducing to you our guest speaker. He's not really a guest to the Worthington Seventh-day Adventist Church. Elder Raj Attiken has been a longtime member here at Worthington. Currently, he is serving as an adjunct professor in the religion department at Kettering College, and he was also our former Ohio Conference president. Now, Elder Raj Attiken will always have a special place in my heart because some years ago he decided to take a chance on a 23-year-old young man and invite him into the Ohio Conference family. And for those who are confused on who that is me I am talking about. And so, Elder Raj, I've always appreciated your leadership and your support to our family, and I'd like to welcome you to the Worthington Seventh-day Adventist Church. I'd like to pray with you before we get started.
Thank you.
Let's pray together. Father in heaven, Lord, I thank you for this wonderful day and the Sabbath and the blessings that you have given us. And Father, I thank you for Elder Raj Attiken. Thank you for his desire to serve you and his ministry, and thank you for his willingness to come and break open the bread of life this morning. So Lord, as he does so and as he presents the message you have laid on his heart this week, we ask that you will anoint his lips with a coal from the heavenly altar. We ask that you that your words and not his words be spoken. We ask that you would give us ears to hear, a mind to understand and discern the message you have for us this morning. And we pray, Lord, as we leave this place, that we will not just hear a great message, but that we will be changed and transformed by your Spirit. Hide Elder Raj Attiken behind the shadow of the cross, and may your name and your name alone be glorified. This is our prayer in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jeremy. It's a pleasure to be here and to occupy this pulpit once again after 42 years of being an employee of the Adventist Church. I decided to leave in a high note, and so the last formal action I took in hiring a pastor is to hire Jeremy. Was that a good decision? Thank you. I thought so. You're a blessing. Thank you. You know, we are all shaped by our stories and our experiences as individuals, as communities of faith, as communities. I'm shaped by my story, where I grew up. It used to be called the third world. We call it now the developing world. And my experiences growing up certainly have shaped who I am and my worldview and how I see things. And that's how it is with all of us. The defining story for the people of Israel in the Old Testament happened in Egypt. I trust that that story is familiar to all of us. It's recorded in the last chapters of the book of Genesis, the first chapters of the book of Exodus. And in that story, there is a Pharaoh who is at the center of power. He is not given a name in the Bible, but he embodies the power and the authority of the Egyptian kingdom. And Pharaoh has power because he has food, he has land, he has slaves, and he has a devious plan. Thanks to the Nile River, Egypt is blessed with food. And so Pharaoh would use food as a weapon. And this is how his plan would work. Hungry peasants in need of food would come to Pharaoh, who had the monopoly on food, and they would pay money for their food, and they would be very happy that Pharaoh was able to provide them food. And of course, in time, food will run out. And so the hungry peasants would come back to Pharaoh, and they would be very happy to give to him their cattle in exchange for food. Of course, in time, the food will run out, and the hungry peasants would come back to Pharaoh and be very happy to give him their land in return for food. So after their money is gone, their cattle is gone, their land is gone, the hungry peasants come back to Pharaoh. And they seem to be happy in the request that they make in Genesis 47 verse 25. Here's what they say to him. You have saved our lives. May it please my Lord, we will be slaves to Pharaoh. If you can imagine that scene. You see, when people are desperate to survive, their desperation leads them to do things that they would otherwise not do. And who can blame them? The story of the 21st century includes some painful elements of desperate families, desperate communities, desperate groups of people. Look at the faces of people at refugee camps, and you see the faces of desperation. Look at the faces of people at border crossings, and you see desperate faces. Look at the faces of people in war-torn places in the world. You see desperation written all over their faces. And so in their desperation, the peasants are willing to become slaves to Pharaoh. Now, as time passes in the story, a new Pharaoh comes into power who does not know the story or does not understand the contribution that the immigrant Israelites had made to the Egyptian economy. And he decides that they are a problem, that they are a threat. And so in the story, he forces them into a production schedule for brick making that is ruthless, that gives no accommodation, no rest to the slaves. And in the story, the immigrant slaves have no rights, no protectors, no guarantors. They are completely vulnerable to the unchecked power of Pharaoh. Now you would think that with all his wealth and power that Pharaoh would be happy. But the biblical narrative portrays Pharaoh as being consumed with anxiety. And so one of his solutions to the immigrant problem is one that has been used over time, different places, and that is to target the children for political gain. He resolves to kill all the baby boys among the immigrant community. And in his erratic madness, Pharaoh actually resolves to destroy the next generation of cheap and free labor. In Exodus chapter 1, verse 16, here's what he says to the midwives. When you help the Hebrew women as they give birth, watch as they deliver. If the baby is a boy, kill him. If it's a girl, let her live. Now, I don't quite get this thing about children being harmed to advance political ends. And it's not just an Egyptian pharaoh who does this. Herod does it at the birth of Jesus. God is said to have done it to the firstborn of Egypt in the 10th plague. God is shown to be behind the slaughter of the Philistine children. Read the books of Joshua and Judges, and there are bloodstains all over, including the blood of children. I don't understand that. But then there comes a carpenter's son, Jesus of Nazareth, who puts it in context in a way that I do understand, where he warned anyone who harms a child. He says, that person deserves to have a boulder tied around his neck and to be thrown into the deepest part of the ocean. Now that's a picture that I can wrap my mind around. So in our story, it is ironic that the one with the most is the one who is most anxious in irrational ways. And the story shows the people of Israel, and in what we might call forced labor camps. They are forced to produce for Pharaoh's economy. Their dignity is stripped away. They are regarded as beasts of burden. That is their life. And then as the story unfolds, it takes a remarkable turn. Exodus 2 verse 23 says, "The Israelites groaned under their slavery and cried out for help." See, the silent slaves, the pawns of Pharaoh, find their voice for the first time, and they will not silently bear their pain anymore. Now, the narrative does not say they cried out to God, or that they cried out to Baal, or that they cried out to Pharaoh. It says they just cried out. They cried out for help. And I suppose if this were being written today, it might read, "The Israelites marched on Goshen," or "The immigrants took to the streets in protest," or that the Israelites organized a Facebook or telephone campaign to call their congressmen, or that the Israelites showed up en masse to vote. It says they cried out. They cried out. See, there are times when we may feel that we have no choice but to put up with the injustice and the cruelty and the harshness with which we are surrounded. There are times when we may feel intimidated about raising our voices against the centers of power and the centers of corruption. But then there come those moments when we feel that enough is enough. We must cry out. We must do something. We are compelled to say something. They cried out, is how the Bible records it. And this one act, a remarkable act on the part of the slaves, whose dignity had been stripped out, whose humanity had been stripped out, this one act of finding and expressing their voice sets in motion a remarkable chain of events. You know the story as it unfolds. Amazing turning point when the newly sounded voice of the slaves draws Yahweh, the God of heaven, into the story for the first time. God shows up. And we might ask, why did it take him so long? Where have you been, O God? Perhaps the answer is that Yahweh waited to be summoned by human cries. Perhaps Yahweh waited until humans were ready to take a step to protest against raw power. And it turns out that in the contest between power and truth, that this God is a magnet who draws pain to his own self, and so God is drawn into the power map of pain in Egypt. And God says to them, "I have seen their misery. I have heard their cries of distress. I'm aware of their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the power of the Egyptians." It is almost as if God is saying, "This is not what I created humans for. This is not what I endowed humans with dignity and respect. Not to be treated as disposable objects, not to be demeaned and defaced, not to be treated as animals. So I have come down to change things." God comes. God is the God who comes. He's the God who comes over and over again for us, to us. He's the God of the Advent, the God who comes. And will come and come and come and come 1,000 times to each of us until one day he comes in glory, the God of the Advent. He comes. finally we can relax if we are in the story. God is going to take care of the problem. God says he feels our pain, he's going to fix it. But just as we take a deep breath and get ready to settle down, rather abruptly, the story takes another turn. Yahweh ends his speech of resolve by saying to Moses, "Now you go. Now you go. Moses, someone needs to stand before Pharaoh. Someone needs to be the carrier, the agent, the witness to truth that challenges unrestrained and abusive power. Someone needs to embody truth and goodness. Moses, you go. Moses, I need for you to be that presence before Pharaoh, just like my son would one day be that presence before Pilate. You go." You know the story. From this moment on, Pharaoh is no longer free to define power and dictate the terms of social or political power. Pharaoh is effectively checked in his power when the ambassador for truth stands before him. And so Moses, the man who thought had no voice, stands before the agent of imperial power and says to him, "God wants you to let my people go." And Pharaoh's first reaction to Moses is, "Say what? Who? I do not know that name. I do not acknowledge that authority. I will not let Israel go." We fast forward the story, and the rest of the story is an account of the way in which power is not free to disregard truth. Things turn out in a way that the agents of power never suspected or anticipated. Pharaoh's power is contested, and it is contested through the drama of a series of plagues. And with each plague, we see the resolve of the Egyptians gradually weaken. Pharaoh is the only one who does not see it or acknowledge it. His most trusted advisors know better, and they come to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh's official said to him, "How long will you let this man hold us hostage? Let the people go to worship their Lord, their God. Don't you realize that Egypt lies in ruins?" Pharaoh's staff, Pharaoh's cabinet, is saying to Pharaoh, "Don't you get it, Mr. Pharaoh? Don't you understand? The country is ruined." Pharaoh and his policy of resistance leave him and his regime in shambles. But raw power that imagines itself to be absolute seldom learns in time. And so the plagues happen. And in the concluding scene of this drama, Pharaoh summons Moses at night and says to him, Exodus 12, "Get out. Leave my people. Take the rest of the Israelites with you. Go and worship the Lord as you have requested." You see, power must now acknowledge truth. And in a twist of irony, Pharaoh ends his brief speech by pleading with Moses, "Go, but bless me as you leave. Bless me as you leave." What a drama. Truth confronts abusive power, and truth ultimately wins. And so a much broken and wounded but joyful community of people, the Israelites, leave in haste in what we know as the Exodus. An enormous caravan, perhaps hundreds of thousands of people, some scholars think maybe up to 1 million. they leave, but they carry with them the physical and emotional wounds of slavery. We are shaped by our stories. Now, the thing about wounds is that they heal, some of them at least. There are those situations when time serves as a balm to heal the wounded soul. There are times when even the most cruel atrocities lose their intensity with the passing of time. But this story, this experience, is of such a critical nature in the identity of the people that it is never to be forgotten. The Hebrew people should never forget the brutal, harsh, degrading experience in Egypt and God's intervention to liberate them. And so every year, they are to gather and in some sort of a reenactment of the scene that they are to observe Passover. Every year, the family is to gather at the dinner table, and a child is to ask, "Father, why is this night different from all other nights?" And the father is to tell the story of slavery and redemption. They were never to forget it. But the abuse of raw power is so distasteful to God that it is not enough to remember it once a year. This is so defining in the life of the Israelites that they are to remember it every week. And so in the second version of the Ten Commandments, in Deuteronomy chapter 5, to the weekly celebration of the Sabbath is added this significance. Deuteronomy 5:15 says, "Remember that you were once slaves in Egypt, but the Lord your God brought you out with a strong hand and powerful arm. That is why the Lord your God has commanded you to rest on the Sabbath." The Sabbath, God says, which was to be a memorial of creation, is to be a memorial of resistance and liberation. In Yahweh's system, there is a God who rests. In all other economic systems, there may be no value to rest, but to production and endless production. But in God, in Yahweh's system, there is value in resting. And the God who rests is the God who emancipates from slavery and consequently from the dehumanizing systems of Egypt. The God who rests is the God who endows humans with dignity, value. The God who rests is the God who includes all, even the stranger, even the beasts of burden, in the blessings of Sabbath. The Sabbath is to remind us that we came from the hands and heart of the Creator, and that we are endowed with dignity as image bearers to the Creator God. The Sabbath is also to remind us that any efforts by those in power to degrade and to divide and to diminish that image is to be resisted now, in anticipation of that day when the God of the Advent will again liberate his people from oppression and repression. The Sabbath was to become a symbol of resistance. Resistance to anxiety, resistance to coercion, resistance to discrimination, resistance to exclusivism. The Sabbath was to become a reminder of the day when truth stood before power and won. And so when I read this incredible story and think of all the nuances embedded into it, I'm led to realize that there is always a Pharaoh as the center of world power. He is not given a name in the Bible, but there's always a Pharaoh in the center of power. If you have seen one Pharaoh, you probably have seen them all. They all act in their same way, in their greedy, uncaring, manipulative, violent self-sufficiency. And when I read this incredible story and think about all the nuances embedded into it, it brings a smile to my heart that the house of power cannot contain the God of truth. When the power of the temple or of the state is brought to bear against truth, morality, and decency, justice, and human dignity, truth stands its ground. That truth is an ancient one, that love endures and overcomes, that greed and hatred destroy, that what is obtained by love is retained, and what is obtained by greed and deceit and lies proves a burden. When I read this incredible story, I understand why the prophetic denunciation of injustice and exclusion and discrimination has a prominent place in the pages of the Bible. I understand why this prophetic strand cannot be removed without gravely distorting our faith. When I read this story, I can understand why the struggle against injustice in all its forms is inscribed in the very character of the Christian faith. It is part of our story. It has shaped who we are. And when I read this incredible story, I can understand better why one Thursday afternoon our Lord Jesus stood before the power of the Roman Empire, before Pontius Pilate, and said to him, "You won't understand this, Pilate, but I was born and came into the world to testify to the truth." The seemingly powerless stands before the powerful. The gentle lamb stands before its formidable shearer. Truth speaks to power. Now, in most Bibles, this episode is labeled Jesus before Pilate. It really should read Pilate before Jesus. You see, it is not truth that is on trial, it is power. It is corruption. It is the deceit of the Jewish hierarchy. And so whether it's a Moses before a Pharaoh, or Elijah before King Ahab, or three Hebrews before King Nebuchadnezzar, or an Esther standing up to a Haman, or Paul before a Felix, or a Festus, or a Agrippa, or Jesus before a Pilate, over time, men and women of faith have seen the need for truth to speak to power and have stepped up to it. And so when I read this incredible story in Exodus, I am nudged into an uncomfortable place of needing to ask, how do I in 2019 speak truth to power? How do I find a voice that advocates for truth in the midst of systems that coerce and control and strip people of their dignity and respect? How do I do that? How I should go about doing that is neither prescribed nor clear. But what is clear is that truth must always, by presence and by voice, speak to power and to greed and to hatred and to deceit and to corruption. What is clear is that we must advocate for justice and goodness and human dignity. What is clear is that we must show by word and by action that the power of truth is more enduring than the power of falsehood and deceit. And so, Jesus said, "You shall know the truth. The truth shall set you free. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall also make you stand for truth." And so I say to this community of faith, let's try to figure this out. Let's try to figure out how this works for us personally and for our faith community in our day, in our place, in our church, in our nation, in our world. God calls us to be ambassadors of truth, speaking truth wherever there is injustice, wherever there is coercion. May we receive the wisdom and the grace that we need to know how to do this in a way that will bring honor and glory to our God. It's my prayer for you today.
Sabbath. Thank you for the message. It's time to return to the Lord a portion of his goodness. May the deacons please come forward. Please bow your heads with me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for giving us another day, Lord, to another opportunity to wake up today and just be a better version of ourselves today than we were yesterday. And we just want to give you the praise and thanks for the many blessings we have, that our bread is sure, that our we have shelter, clothing, and just all the felt needs that you provide for us every day. And Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity to be able to give back to you. Lord, we pray that your spirit will lead us to find ways to be a blessing to others throughout this day and throughout the upcoming week. We ask all these things in Jesus' precious and holy name. Amen.
Thank you, Elder, for that amazing sermon. Shall we all stand together? Hymn 545, Savior Like a Shepherd Leads Us. Hymn 545. Everyone with me.
Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us, as we need thy tenderest care. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast brought us, thine we are. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, thou hast brought us, thine we are. Savior, thine own mother created us, be the guardian of our way. Keep thy flock within thee, defend us, seek us when we go astray. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, hear, O hear us. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, hear, O hear us when we pray. Thou hast promised to receive us, poor and sinful though we be. Thou hast mercy to relieve us, grace to cleanse and power to free. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, we will early turn to Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, we will early turn to thee.
We ask, O gracious God, that the grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit will remain with us all now and forevermore. Amen.